to go here in Morgantown for the Big 12 opener. 2-1 K-State coming into town to take on the 12th-ranked West Virginia Mountaineers. They haven't played in 2 weeks. They are lathered up and ready to go. Welcome to college football on ESPN, presented by PlayStation 4. Clay Matvick and Dan Orlovsky, Paul Carcaterra will be down on the sidelines here today. It's always fun to come to Morgantown. We're going to see one of the best quarterbacks in the country today.
And Will Grier's ability to have anticipation and accuracy as good as anybody in the country.
He's a fifth-year senior, 23 years old. He has a wife and daughter. In 2015, he led Florida to a 6-0 start before testing positive for a banned substance. Resurfaced here after a one-year suspension. Great numbers last year despite a broken finger late, and he's a Heisman candidate this year.
He's got a bunch of weapons to get the ball to, and if West Virginia keeps winning, he'll be in that Heisman talk all season long.
Preseason All-American, Heisman hopeful, has really looked the part through the first two games. West Virginia did not play last week because of Hurricane Florence, so the game with NC State was canceled. We've had plenty of time to prepare for K-State, who won the toss and elected to defer. So we're going to see Will Grier in the offense for West Virginia right away. Ball is in the air. We're underway here at Milan Pushkar Stadium. It's Marcus Sims on the return. Good coverage by the Wildcats. Sims only able to get to the 15-yard line. And here comes Will Grier. 6'2", 223-pound senior out of Charlotte, North Carolina. 9 touchdown passes, just 1 pick. 11 of his 13 games at West Virginia, he has gone over 300 yards. Every time he takes the field, Dano, something special could happen. He's got Martell Petaway in the backfield with him on the first play from scrimmage. He'll roll out to his left, looking to throw on first down. He's going to take a shot. Ball hangs up, looking for David Sills, his main man, and it lands incomplete. Double coverage there. Ball a little sloppy out of the hand of Grier to start.
That one didn't come out as clean as he would like. I do love the fact that they're taking a shot on first down the field to start this game. But it will be something to pay attention to. Clay, you mentioned the 2 weeks off. Do they come out fresh and fast, or does it take time to get them in rhythm?
And an impressive win over Tennessee in the opener. Blew out Youngstown State a couple of weeks ago. And it's been a while. Here's Gary Jennings making a catch. And that's going to make it third and manageable. Jennings, one of the great receivers that Will Grier has at his disposal.
Nice job by West Virginia getting to a little bit of a stacked receiver set. They love quick game out of it.
Third down and 3. They're going to pick up the first down. David Sills moves the chains, got to the 34-yard line. Pickup of 12 yards for West Virginia.
And that's something Sills has really taken the next step in. He's an outside receiver for sure, but they move him in the slot. Patience on the route. Good first down for West Virginia.
Petaway in the backfield on first down. They're going to give it to the big junior from Detroit. And he'll burrow ahead. Jordan Mitty, grad transfer from Texas State, makes the tackle from his defensive tackle spot. This is a defense that has been struggling at times here in the early parts of the season for K-State.
They didn't play well against Mississippi State, but there was also some stuff that Mississippi State did scheme-wise to really take advantage of quarterback run. They didn't tackle well, so this is a good K-State D.
Series for the Mountaineers. Grier has all day to throw, comes over the middle and is complete. There's Sims trying to spin out of a tackle at the 49. They'll move the chains again.
You want to things that Greer does really well is hang in the pocket, see coverages, find receivers crossing over the middle. For a guy that's not super tall, he's got great vision.
Greer to throw again, another deep shot, looking for Sims, and that's intercepted. Picked off by A.J. Parker, the sophomore out of Oklahoma. And Will Greer throws his second interception of the year. Kansas State will take over. For Will Greer and company, but he just threw an interception, and K-State takes over. From their own 6-yard line, it's Alex Barnes on the run, and it's a good one on first down. We were curious, Dan Orlovsky, how Will Greer and West Virginia would look today after so much time off. And they didn't look good on that opening drive.
Some good plays. The interception is looks like a miscommunication between Greer and his receiver. Beautiful play down the field by A.J. Parker for Kansas State.
He's Dan Orlovsky. I'm Clay Maffitt. Paul Carcaterra down on the field. Skylar Thompson, a quarterback for the Wildcats, and he gives it to Alex Barnes. So here is the interception moments ago from A.J. Parker, the sophomore cornerback out of Bartlesville, Oklahoma. It's the second time on that opening series we saw Greer float a pass.
It looks like Greer's thinking you're going outside, Sims, and Sims takes it to the post. So that's something on the sidelines. He's going to go back, talk to Sims about what did you see to make sure that mistake doesn't happen again.
First possession for the Wildcats. First down and 10 from the 17-yard line. Thompson's going to run. And that's what K-State wants to do. Has established the run, and especially the quarterback run, such a staple of what K-State does. It's Skylar Thompson running this offense, sophomore out of Independence, Missouri, making his 8th straight start going back to last season. He found some rhythm last week against UTSA.
Played very well last week, and certainly they want to run, but Skylar Thompson can do both.
Over 200 yards passing, a couple of touchdowns, also ran for a touchdown against the Roadrunners. Here's Alex Barnes to the 23. He's going to bring up third down for K-State. Kenny Bigelow with the tackle up front. Let's take a look at the impact players.
Yeah, I mean, for Kansas State on offense, Skylar Thompson has to have a great day of protecting the football and making throws down the field. Isaiah Zuber, his receiver, can make you fall down at DB. And then Kenny Bigelow is going to play on the center's head. Great penetration has totally transformed this West Virginia defense.
And they're playing with a chip on their shoulder, according to Tony Gibson, the defensive coordinator. Let's see what they can do here on third down and 4. They bring some pressure off the edge. The run right up the middle is stuffed. Fourth down for K-State, no gain. David Long, the weak side linebacker, number 11, made the stop.
So they bring their bandit safety, Toyus Avery, off the edge. Means everybody in that defensive line slants right into where Kansas State is trying to run the football, and West Virginia gets off the field after the turnover.
And the interception thrown by Will Greer doesn't hurt West Virginia. It's Rodriguez to punt. Marcus Sims back to return, and it's going to go out of bounds. Good field position for the Mountaineers after that 32-yard punt. When we come back to Morgantown, 9:26 to go here in the first. The beautiful West Virginia campus. Always love coming to Morgantown. Great fans. They got the memo today. Strike the stadium. Got the proper attire on for their section. Here's Will Greer going to the air. That's through the hands of the intended man, T.J. Simmons, the Alabama transfer. Lands incomplete. Will Greer, preseason All-American, He's going to be in the Heisman running, we think, right until the bitter end this year, Dan Orlovsky.
If West Virginia keeps winning, there's no doubt about it. He's so many weapons.
Finds his main man, David Sills, who stumbles across the midfield stripe. David Sills, one of the top receivers in the country, at 18 touchdown catches last year. It's a pickup of five, third down and five.
Sills, one of Greer's best friends, the ex-quarterback himself, but this is a big moment because West Virginia offensively has really put an emphasis on third down. So how do they move David Sills around to get matchups?
He's looking to that side of the field again, but this time he finds Giovanni Haskins. The big tight end, the Miami transfer, picks up 15 yards, and it's a first down.
One of the things that David Greer impressed me with was his knowledge. Kansas State brings a cornerback blitz. He throws right into the blitz, which is what quarterbacks should do. Conversion to Haskins. Well done.
Second-year offensive coordinator Jake Spavital wanting to use the tight ends more this year. He's really trying to establish them again. Here's Tevin Bush with his first touch. Catch and run on first down. As West Virginia's in K-State territory for the second time already today, that first series resulted in a turnover, an interception thrown by Greer, his second of the year.
But I love that play by offensive coordinator Jake Spavital because it's an extension of the run game. You got to do little things against this Kansas State defense really well over four quarters.
Under 8 minutes to go here, opening quarter. Lenny Brown, the freshman, lost the football. Scramble for it. Who's got it? K-State does. Second, West Virginia
fumble recovered by the defense. First down, Kansas State. Timeout on the field.
Jordan Mitty, the defensive tackle, recovers for the Cats.
And Clay, this is a West Virginia team that hasn't played in 2 weeks. So it's either come out fast and firing on all cylinders, or does it take you some time to get going? A basic handoff with a true freshman at tailback. Now another turnover for West Virginia this early on, and this is what K-State wanted.
No
to get some turnovers, fast start.
Yeah, this is the recipe for an upset on the road. Forcing turnovers. K-State minus five in turnovers coming into the game. Plus two so far today. Play fake. Thompson pressured, chased, and brought down at the 16-yard line, and a penalty flag flies. Josh Norwood may be called for a horse collar here. The junior corner.
Personal foul. Horse collar tackle, defense number four. The quarterback was outside of the pocket. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
The former Ohio State Buckeye with the mistake. That one's going to really cost West Virginia.
It's the right call. He's outside of the pocket. If he was in the pocket, it'd be a different story. Norwood, a guy that West Virginia loves to blitz off the edge. Unfortunate there with the penalty.
And that's going to be a loss of a few on the play. Dalvin Warmack with his first touch, and Dylan Tonkery, middle linebacker, was there. So is number nine, Javonte Stewart for West Virginia. Might be the shortest Sam linebacker in college football right now.
They love his speed, though, Clay, and a West Virginia defense that's second right now in the Big 12 Conference tackles for loss. They believe if they get a first down tackle for loss, that's a three and out.
Stewart, 5'8", 195 pounds. They've got some injuries at linebacker, and they've moved him from the secondary. Thompson scrambling. He's going to get back to the original line of scrimmage. Toyus Avery chops him down. That's going to be a third and long here for K-State. As this offense is having a hard time, Dano, finding some traction early.
And it goes back to that tackle for loss. Tony Gibson, their defensive coordinator, said, I'll give up some stuff structurally to get these tackles for losses because he doesn't believe anybody is going to convert a lot of third and longs against this aggressive, athletic West Virginia defense.
K-State just 40% on third down this year. Whistle the play dead. A timeout called for by K-State.
This is the first charge. Timeout for Kansas State. Timeout on the field.
Bill Snyder and the Kansas State Wildcats want to talk here. Under 6 minutes to go, opening quarter. No score in Morgantown. An old tradition here, the Mountaineer man trip about 2.5 hours before kickoff. The coaching staff and players enter the stadium, paying tribute to the coal miners here in West Virginia. But a couple of weeks ago, they started a new tradition. The team gathers and acknowledges the children across the parking lot at the WVU Children's Hospital. Just a great gesture. And that's a new tradition we think is going to stick around here in Morgantown for a long time.
Yeah, as an ex-player and a guy who's a dad, that'll pull at your heart. It's really awesome by West Virginia and their whole community what they're doing over there at WVU.
Clay Matvick, Dan Orlovsky, Paul Carcaterra back here at Mile and Pushcar Stadium. K-State out of the timeout. Third down and long. Wildcats have it at their own 41. West Virginia has turned it over twice already here today. They've only had two possessions. Thompson facing some pressure, dumps it off to Barnes, gets to the 40, and he's hammered down. Fourth down. Drayvon Askew-Henry, the Spurs safety, throwing his weight around, and the Wildcats will have to punt.
And it's really the West Virginia defense once again bailing out their offense, but Drayvon Askew-Henry, beautiful job, because Kansas State called that screen right into a cornerback blitz, which is ideal. Nice job of shedding a block, making a tackle.
First-year punter Andrew Hicks comes on for K-State, a boomer. Lands at the two, checks up. Great kick by Andrew Hicks, the redshirt freshman out of Shawnee, Kansas. Bangs one 57 yards, a long field for the Mountaineers when we come back.
You're a dad now. You're also a husband. How has that changed you as a quarterback?
Well, I think there's a sort of maturity that comes along with being a dad and a husband, but you know, I've played quarterback for a long time. I love this game. I love the team aspect of things, and I try to be a leader on and off the field. And it's, you know, really a blessing to be able to go home to a healthy, happy family. And I try and incorporate positivity with that to the rest of my teammates.
A leader at home as well.
Oh, yeah.
Got to ask you though, from a scenario standpoint, a backside blitz or waking up in the middle of the night changing a diaper, what's tougher?
The diaper. 10 times out of 10, change the diaper. It's just how it is. You'll know when you do it.
Good interview with Paul Carcaterra and Will Greer, the Heisman candidate at quarterback. Just completed a pass to Sims. He's got him again. And he gets loose inside the 20. Goodbye, touchdown. The first two series for the Mountaineers were dismal. But this is a quick strike offense, and Greer hits Sims for an 82-yard touchdown play. Evan Staley with the extra point, and it's 7-0 Mountaineers. Two plays, 35 seconds, and Greer hits Marcus Sims. It's his first touchdown catch of the year.
And it's really the same play. They ran first down, just an easy completion, a little 8-yard stop to Sims. They come back, and it's a double move right off that initial first down play. Beautiful ball by Greer, and Sims way too fast down the field, running away from the Kansas State defense. I loved how they ran that play back to back and got the corner to sit. A.J. Parker playing DB for Kansas State saw one thing on first down. Second down, come back, see the same exact thing with just a little bit of a wrinkle. Well done by their offensive coordinator, Jake Spavital.
On the first series, Greer threw a pick. Second series, Letty Brown put it on the turf. Two series, two turnovers. But on series number three, a little magic. Greer, 82 yards to Sims. PlayStation Player Index. Closer look at Will Greer, the senior from Charlotte, North Carolina, who started his career at Florida. 11 of his 13 games before today here at West Virginia, he's gone for over 300 yards.
That's a ridiculous stat that he's played that well, you know, that early on. And they ask him to do a lot at the line of scrimmage, making checks in their run game, changing their protections. Said the really, the thing that he's done next level is understand matchups with receivers. We saw it right there with Marcus Sims.
And we listened to the Paul Carcaterra interview. You know, he's got a lot of layers. He's a family man, wife and daughter. He's shown a lot of maturity here in recent years. It's helped him on the field.
It's helped the whole team. That maturity has spread throughout their whole football team. And it's a reason why West Virginia is going to be in this conversation moving forward.
Evan Staley, the kickoff. Isaiah Zuber and Duke Shelley to return. And it'll be Shelley stepping out of bounds near the 10-yard line. And let's go to Adnan Burke with an update. All right, Adnan. All right, so Alabama putting up points. There's your shocker.
They scored again. That's weird.
I guess the biggest question, Dan, was do they put up 50 again today? All right, K-State has it back. They're going to start this drive at their own 10. Skylar Thompson out of the gun. He's going to keep it. And there is nowhere to go. Trying to cut the corner on the near side, and he was just leveled. Toya Zavery, the Bandit safety, knocking Thompson down hard.
And that's the guy for the West Virginia defense that should be in the mix for so many tackles, is that Bandit safety. He's always down into the boundary. They kick everything back to him. And West Virginia's defense showing off how fast they can be.
Here's Thompson out in the end zone. He's going to throw it this time. It's a low throw, but caught at the 14-yard line by Royer. Zach Royer, a senior, hasn't made a lot of catches in his career. Getting his first touch. That's a gain of 7. And another third down here for K-State, who has not been ahead of the chains a lot here in the first few games of the year.
And on first down, what did you have? Another tackle for loss, which leads you to now this 3rd and 6, and West Virginia can do some creative stuff.
See what offensive coordinator Andre Coleman draws up here on 3rd down and 6. Thompson, all kinds of time to throw. That veteran O-line protecting him, but nothing downfield. No flags. Intended for Isaiah Harris, and K-State will have to punt again.
Beautiful job by West Virginia in man coverage. You're just staying sticky on guys' hips. And Josh Norwood, who in that previous drive blitzed and had a horse collar all over the Kansas State receiver.
Second straight 3 and out for K-State. This is Andrew Hicks, another boomer. Backing Sims off, but now gets loose to the middle of the field, slides down short of the 50. And Will Greer will hit him. 8 Eastern on ABC, and Mel Kiper has Ducks quarterback Justin Herbert number one on his list as far as quarterbacks ready to go.
He'll be tested tonight. That Stanford defense has given up 23 points all year so far.
Drew Locke put up some numbers today against Georgia in a loss. Kennedy McCoy with the carry. To bring up 2nd down and 7.
Jake Spavital, offensive coordinator Jake Spavital. And then you have Will Greer at quarterback. And then David Sills, he's so active with this wide receiver group on the sidelines between possessions. Remember, he was a quarterback himself too, Clay.
And great communication on this offensive unit, no doubt. McCoy on this run. And Will Greer is a coach's son. His dad coached him in high school. Spav is a coach's son. His dad coached him in high school. Still is a high school coach. They seem to know how to speak the language.
Oh, absolutely. Getting a chance to talk with them yesterday, very much so on the same page. They say one of the greatest things about them and their relationship, the dialogue that they have in-game.
Spavadola, veteran play caller. Stops at Cal, A&M, Houston. And that's incomplete. On third down and three, intended for Simmons. Duke Shelley, one of the best corners in the Big 12, broke it up. Let's go back to Adnan. All right, Adnan. Boy, that Ohio State offense with Dwayne Haskins at quarterback, it's like they've got new life, a different spirit on that side of the ball.
They're no longer one-dimensional. He's brought a pass game to that offense.
First punt for Billy Kinney of West Virginia. And Shelley on the fair catch. K-State will have it at the 13-yard line. Pac-12 After Dark, Arizona State and number 10 Washington on ESPN. Some great games on this college football Saturday. Clay Matvick, Dan Orlovsky, Paul Carcaterra here in Morgantown. Thompson in trouble, able to get rid of it to Zuber. He catches it at the 15 and then it's taken off his cleats by Akeem Bailey. This defense is moving with lightning speed today.
It's one of the things that they teach their guys. Play fast and be in space. Dylan Tonkery, their middle linebacker, creating special pressure. And Akeem Bailey, beautiful job playing in coverage.
This might be the most improved defense in the Big 12 this year when it's all said and done. Fake to Barnes, pass complete to Zuber, first down across the 30, down to the 32.
Skylar Thompson the defensive coordinator for West Virginia. The way to get to this offense is pressure, pressure, pressure on Skylar Thompson, and he's been reminding his defense every time they come off the field.
Here's Tony, Boone County, West Virginia native, right in the heart of cold country. He is really proud of his group this year. First and 10, Thompson rolling out to his left. He'll dump it off short. And that's caught by Blaze Gammon, the tight end, just his second career catch. The other main tight end, Nick Lenners, is out today with an injury.
And I love those two play calls back-to-back by Kansas State because something West Virginia has been a little bit susceptible to is some play-action passes. So I like those back-to-back for Kansas State.
Second and short, a very powerful Barnes will pick up the first down. Third in the Big 12 in rushing, 76 yards per game. He's going to do most of the heavy lifting today in that K-State run game. But we talked about it before, Dan. You always got to be wary of the quarterback taking off when you play K-State.
And that's something that Tony Gibson for West Virginia, their coordinator, has to be aware of because that pressure sounds great. But if that quarterback run game for Kansas State finds a crease, Skylar Thompson can run.
Let's see if they get another snap off. And they will not. So we have one touchdown in the first 15 minutes. It's a big strike touchdown from the Heisman hopeful, Will Greer. He finds Marcus Sims on an 82-yard connection. 7-0 Mountaineers after one. You're watching college football on ESPN, presented by PlayStation 4. As we get ready to start the second quarter, it's 7-0, number 12, West Virginia, leading K-State, Big 12 opener for these two. When these teams get together, these games seem to be close. The last four decided by 6 points or less. And West Virginia has won the last two, including last year in Manhattan, despite four first-half turnovers for West Virginia, and they didn't score any points after the half. Able to scratch out a win. They've turned it over twice already today, but West Virginia has the lead. First and 10, K-State, pass complete, penalty flag down. I see Harris on that catch.
Personal foul. Illegal hands to the face. Offense, number 61. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. It's first down. The player whose helmet was removed does not have to go out of the game due to the foul.
It's a veteran O-line for K-State. Abdul Beecham, the senior right guard, with the mistake here.
And like you mentioned, a veteran offensive lineman not playing that great right now. Credit to West Virginia. The penetration is what forces this. They are so fast and explosive upfield as a defensive line right now. Sometimes offensive linemen have to find a way to get hands on.
They returned everybody up front. 129 career starts entering play today. That is caught by Zuber at the 43. He has been the best player for this K-State offense here the first few weeks. Gets back close to the original line of scrimmage. He'll be second down at about 12.
Really just a beautiful throw by Skylar Thompson, because David Long, the weak linebacker for West Virginia, is dropping underneath that. Almost there, but another play-action pass completed for Kansas State.
This ruling of a catch is under review.
So we're going to look back at that Isaiah Zuber grab.
Time out on the field.
And we're going to step aside while they peek at it. 14-12 to go here before half. 7-0 West Virginia. Now the play is going to stand. Isaiah Zuber. A play ruled a catch. Replay official today, Don Caprell. And this is an offense that at times has struggled. Only had 213 yards of total offense a couple of weeks ago against Mississippi State. But Thompson is now 6 of 7 passing, 48 yards. And he could run too, but this time bottled up and brought down by the West Virginia defense. Josh Norwood, another tackle for the Mountaineers. And it's third down and long.
There's a tackle for loss for the West Virginia defense. Norwood doing a nice job of coming off in coverage. And now in third down, Tony Gibson gets to get a little creative with some secondary blitzes.
That's their third tackle for loss today for the Mountaineers. They've got 24 of those on the year. These third down situations have been an Achilles heel. Thompson chased out of the pocket, still eyes downfield. He'll throw it away. And the punter for the Wildcats getting a workout today.
And it's Tony Gibson, the West Virginia defensive coordinator, dialing it up again. You get the third and long, he's coming with pressure. And he brings a cornerback blitz at the bottom of our screen off the boundary. Too many people to block for Kansas State up front. Outnumbered. Allows a free rusher to get home. Skylar Thompson nowhere to go with the football.
Fourth punt for Hicks. And he drops it at the 21-yard line. The penalty really hurt K-State on that last drive. They trail West Virginia here on the road in Morgantown, 7-0. John Denver's Country Road should be playing under those shots. Mother's season, Taco Bell is celebrating student sections and passionate fans like these by awarding the best student section of the year. The West Virginia Mountaineer student section already on the national watch list. Go to ESPN.com/Taco Bell to see how your school can compete. Clay Mapic, Dan Orlovsky, Paul Carcaterra here in Morgantown. West Virginia has the football back. And it's Martell Petaway, one of the four running backs that the Mountaineers are going to use this year. The only one we won't see today, Alex Sinkfield, out with a high ankle sprain. Second down and 7. Will Greer, 8 for 12, 154 yards, a touchdown, and an interception thrown for the Heisman hopeful. He'll hand off. It's Petaway again. Tries to get to the 30. He stops just short of there, and it'll be a couple of yards short of the first down. Third down coming up.
But this is why those first and second down positive carries matter, because now you're in third and three if you're West Virginia. And Will Greer's got four weapons that he can just stand over the defense and say, if you're going to play me in man, which a lot of teams do on third and short, you got really good options to get the ball to.
He's got two receivers to either side. Coming up on 12 minutes to go before halftime. Greer looks to his left, throws. The slant route is complete. Caught at the 40 by Sims. He has been their best receiver today. That's another 10-yard pickup. A.J. Parker made the tackle. They'll move the sticks.
And that's a man beater right there, Clay. Inside receiver runs just a vertical. The outside receiver comes right underneath him. All you need is 5 or 6 yards. That's why those first and second down carries are important.
118 yards receiving already today for Sims. Petaway runs into a wall and falls down. Maybe picks up a yard. Eli Walker got in there to knock it down. The second straight start and strong safety for K-State. Denzel Goolsbee is out with an undisclosed injury.
Pretty good shot right there by Eli Walker. Plays like that remind me of, I was very thankful to have played quarterback.
Greer, all kinds of time. He's complete to Sills. David Sills on the comebacker. Turns and runs it to the 45. Walker brings him down there. It's a gain of 6. So it'll bring up third down and manageable here for West Virginia.
Kansas State and their defensive coordinator, Blake Seiler, might have to start thinking about bringing some pressure, because the four-man rush,
not on the field for injury,
not enough to get home on Will Greer.
You get a man down for K-State. It's Walter Neal, the nickelback.
How nice was it to watch Will Greer in the pocket there just move through progressions? You know, he's certainly a physically talented kid, but very smart in understanding coverages and how to get through stuff to his playmakers.
Smart and so smooth. Also smart and smooth, Adnan Virk. It's odds to win the Heisman right now. And we talked about it at the top of the broadcast, Dan. You don't win the Heisman in September, but you certainly can go a long way to winning it by having a good month.
And now that you're playing a defense with their nickel back out, Walter Neal, Will Greer will attack.
West Virginia 3 of 4 today on third down. They need 3. Greer, Cox fires to the outside, complete to Jennings. Gary Jennings coming off a 3-touchdown game against Youngstown State. He gets 7 to move the chains.
It's just beautiful patience by Gary Jennings in the slot. A little hesitation, nice quick out route, and that's where those third and shorts are really beneficial to get into.
Back in Wildcats territory. Under the gun, they'll run it. There's Letty Brown. He had that fumble on the second series. Apparently back in the good graces. Dana Holgerson runs ahead. Patton makes the tackle. Going back to Gary Jennings, the senior receiver for West Virginia. He had 97 catches last year, Dan, but only 1 touchdown. Already has 4 touchdowns this year, and I don't think it's by accident.
It's just product of offense, right? You got a bunch of good players. Sometimes you get tackled inside the 5. There's just so much distribution within this offense. He's already started to get his.
Yeah, Will Greer making a little extra effort to find Jennings. Looking for a receiver here. He finds his buddy Sills. David Sills steps out of bounds after a first down pickup, a gain of 9 to the 36-yard line.
And how about this offensive line providing protection for Will Greer? And I said it before, he's not just a thrower, playing quarterback, great feet within the pocket, moving around and finding Sills in a soft zone.
That's the stuff that the NFL scouts have been noticing. Brown burrows ahead. The 32, Patton and Durham combine on the stop for K-State.
And he really is, Will Greer really is a better athlete than people give him credit for. When you watch tape on him, the pocket presence, the ability to move in a small space stands out.
Quarterback has won the Heisman 8 of the last 10 years. Certainly looks like that's going to be the case again. Is your Greer hoping to be in New York at the end of the season? Hubert makes the stop on Brown. Another third down situation for the West Virginia Mountaineers. Third and four.
And they've just done such a nice job of getting into these manageable third down situations. It's a very simple way of playing football. And now they can move David Sills around wherever they want, bringing him into the slot. Don't be surprised if we get another type of rub concept from these receivers.
Sliding up in the pocket, Greer gets in trouble, and down he goes. Sacked by Jordan Mitty, who's having a pretty good first half for the Wildcats. And Trey Deshaun also in there.
I love it from the Kansas State defense. They really showed an all-out blitz. Looked like everyone's going to blitz, and they drop out. Everyone pops out in coverage. Maybe it fooled Will Greer and West Virginia offense there. Big sack to force a long field goal attempt for Kansas State.
Now, Evan Staley having a pretty good year so far. 3 for 3, a long of 35. This is way outside of his normal range, though. A 51-yard attempt. Evan Staley, whose career long up to now 36 yards, tries from 51. West Virginia comes up empty on the drive, and the score remains 7-0.
Tell. Clay.
All right, Adnan, thank you very much. K-State has the ball back, and Skylar Thompson is complete on first down. Best starting field position for K-State. It's Isaiah Zuber on the reception. So after that long drive for West Virginia, Dano, 12 plays, over 6 minutes, they missed the field goal. And the difference in this game remains that one play, that long pass play, 82 yards, Greer to Sims. Dalvin Warmack, and it looks like he's going to be short of the first down. Third down coming up, down to Paul.
Skylar Thompson was just on the phone with his common presence, who's Colin Klein, now the co-offensive coordinator. Klein, the 2012 Heisman Trophy finalist, was a GA and recruited Thompson. The first 2 weeks of the season, gentlemen, he was down on the field, but now he's back in the booth where he was last year as the quarterback's coach. He's Skylar's eyes from up top, and the two have a wonderful relationship. Thompson playing in that same exact offense that Klein once did.
What a great resource for Skylar Thompson, the young quarterback.
Huge. I mean, he can see things and attest to things that nobody else in the program can.
And Thompson wants time to talk about this next move. They haven't completed a conversion on third down yet, and they trail by a touchdown. Time for our Aflac trivia question.
Aflac!
Bill Snyder's first season at K-State was 1989. The question, where was Dana Holgorsen in 1989? Something to think about.
Got a couple answers.
Alex Barnes in the backfield at Skylar Thompson trying to pick up the first down himself. See if they'll move the chains. K-State hasn't converted a third down yet today.
I mean, I know you love your offensive line, but
you have to measure.
Run quarterback sneak right at Kenny Bigelow, who is a transfer over to West Virginia from USC at 310 pounds or so. As a quarterback, I would have. I said, Coach, can we get something different in here?
Bigelow has been terrific for West Virginia. And they didn't get it. About an inch short. And now we'll see what Bill Snyder decides to do. K-State now 0 for 5 on third down.
Yeah, it almost looked like Skylar Thompson waited when he got the snap. Didn't go forward. That's, as a quarterback, you really got to almost anticipate catching that snap and leaning at the same time. That's the difference between that inch or two for Kansas State.
have been so many offensive inconsistencies this year for K-State, but the biggest one probably has been third down. Alex Barnes in the backfield. Thompson sneaks up under center. As this crowd comes pouring down on Thompson. Watch a pitch, hit the backfield, and down goes Barnes. Jabari Stewart and Dylan Tankery. They combine on another tackle for loss. And West Virginia will take over on downs.
That's why, Clay, sometimes size doesn't matter. Jabari Stewart, so fast, able to play both guys. And then Dylan Tankery called out last week, not making enough tackles. The speed of the West Virginia defense on full display, swarming to the ball carrier, Alex Barnes.
Yeah. Tony Gibson couldn't remember the last time a middle linebacker did not have one single tackle in a football game. That was the case for Tonkery, but he and Stewart combined on a big hit. And now here goes Greer and the Mountaineers back on offense. Deep shot. Jennings threw his hands, incomplete. Oh, that should have been a touchdown for Gary Jennings. Greer knew it.
This is something that good football teams do. You get a turnover, you take a shot. They try to get Jennings down the seam on a post. Beautiful throw again by Greer. Uncharacteristic of Gary Jennings, and Will Greer not happy. Not happy with the drop.
Greer with one touchdown pass today. Closing in on 200 yards through the air. Draw play. Kennedy McCoy, big run up the middle. First down and more to the 25. Kennedy McCoy, an athletic junior. Touchdowns in each of the first two games for West Virginia. They've got some depth at that position.
It's a big emphasis for their team. Again, everyone knows the weapons that Will Greer and his receivers are. But this run game is going to be something that allows this team to really contest for a conference championship.
And go back to McCoy. Find some room on the left side. It's going to be close to another first down for McCoy. Last year, Justin Crawford was a 1,000-yard rusher. This year, it's been by committee in the backfield. Knocking on the door in the red zone. And it has been a playground through the first couple of games for Dana Holgerson's squad. As a man is down, Kevion McGee. And now the crowd is finding displeasure in the fact that McGee is down, maybe thinking that he's trying to buy a break here for the K-State defense. Now, Dana Holgerson always fired up. He admittedly has a Red Bull addiction. And they give it to the running back. McCoy again, who streaks free to the pylon. Did he get in? Well, they're going to mark him out.
Early on the field.
About the 1 yard line.
Runner was out of bounds before the ball broke the plane of the goal line. First down.
This West Virginia run game starting to get going. The left side of the offensive line completely collapses Kansas State. They get a couple pullers to get McCoy on the edge. Then big-time effort just short of the goal line.
Great play by Patton, junior college All-American last year.
Watch out for David Sills, bottom bar screen and one-on-one.
McCoy in the backfield to the right of Greer. And we're going to get a timeout. West Virginia.
Prior to the snap, delay of game. Offense, 5-yard penalty. It's first down.
Tried to get the timeout called from the sideline, but not in time. It's a delay of game penalty. Their second penalty here in the half. Kirk.
Dana Holgerson is upset, and he should be, because I'm about 5 feet from him, and he ran down the sideline, and he called that timeout
prior to the play. An official saw the coach call timeout.
Just made the announcement to the crowd they're going to change that. It is indeed a timeout for West Virginia. We will also step aside. Well, Dana Holgorsen got his way, Dano. You usually see a coach falling on deaf ears, but he got it this time.
You yell at those officials enough, then at some point they'll give you a break or two.
West Virginia this year, 9 of 9 in the red zone, 6 touchdowns. This is the first trip today for the Mountaineers. They're right on the doorstep. They might get another timeout. And this time it's from K-State sideline.
This is the third and final charge timeout for Kansas State. 30 seconds.
All right, so let's go back to our Aflac trivia question. Bill Snyder's first season at K-State was 1989. Where was Dana Holgorsen at that time? The answer, Mount Pleasant Community High School in Mount Pleasant, Iowa. So down in the southeast corner of the state of Iowa, where he's a pretty good basketball player. But look at how young Bill Snyder looks there when he took over the reins in Manhattan.
Holgorsen can elevate a little bit.
In 1989, Dan Orlovsky wasn't shaving yet. Neither was Paul Carpetera. That was getting close.
Clay, your hair hasn't changed.
That's about the same. Bad haircut.
You might be wearing. I want you to come do a game in a tux too.
Oh, the good old days.
I'm telling you, Kansas State one on one up top with David Sills.
They give it to Lenny Brown as he is stuffed. And isn't able to get through Elijah Sullivan. He did not play last week because of a knee injury. Comes in. And that goal line situation, it makes it a nice stop, so it's second down and goal. As we go under 3 minutes before half.
And I love this formation right now by West Virginia. Use the whole field, put Sills down by himself, and if you like it, take it.
High snap. Greer has to chase. Now has to improvise to the end zone. Incomplete. Travon Wesco, the tight end, couldn't haul it in. And it'll be third down.
Well, Jake Spavital in his background has worked with Johnny Manziel before. Well, Greer with the little Johnny Manziel play here. Beautiful job of catching a bounce and just being ready to make a play. Should have been a touchdown now in third and goal against the Kansas State defense that makes you earn every single point.
Center has been a trouble spot for West Virginia. They've rotated a couple of guys there. That snap went high, but here they get it in. Touchdown, Mountaineers. It's David Sills. His third touchdown catch of the year.
You know, Clay, sometimes football isn't that hard. It's David Sills is probably picked first at recess a bunch because he's a really good athlete and very tall. It's the same thing. My guy, better than your guy. Easy slant, uses his body, touchdown.
Former high school quarterback, second stint at West Virginia as a wide receiver. As Evan Staley tacks on the extra point, it's a 7-play, 39-yard drive. In 2:31, took over with great field position after the defensive stand. Took a while to get it in, but they do, and they find their top receiver, David Sills.
And they just gave him the whole field to work with from the left hash. He could run a slant if he wants, or he could run a fade to the back corner. Used his nice big body, get a little distance away from that DB. It's too easy to play him. It's too easy for this West Virginia offense if you're going to play them one-on-one.
Last year, 18 touchdowns for David Sills. That was number one in the FBS. Well, he's doing it again, but this season he's on a mission to prove that he's more than just a red zone target. He gained 12 pounds. He wants to be the complete package, and I spent some time with him last year, seen him this year. He has a full year, a full off season for the first time being a complete wide receiver. I love this kid.
He may be the best wide receiver option mismatch in all of college football right now.
He and I have something in common.
You and David Sills?
Yeah, I also gained 12 pounds this offseason.
Yours wasn't to beat man-to-man coverage.
So what is the future for him?
NFL?
He certainly has an NFL future. Very tall, athletic, smart, understands football, great hands. There's always places for guys like that in the NFL.
Isaiah Zuber from the 4-yard line for K-State. He gets across the 20, takes a shot down at the 22. And let's go to Adnan in the studio. Yeah. Yeah, he showed us his cooler yesterday, full of Red Bull.
He doesn't run away from it. It's a badge of honor for Dana Holgorsen.
Bill Snyder's got a fast food addiction. Holgorsen's got a Red Bull addiction. So K-State down a couple of touchdowns now. This is Barnes, and he's going to get six. We're talking about wide receivers. David Sills certainly one of the best. And here are your top quarterback wide receiver duos.
Tua and Jerry Jeudy are just on a different level right now, but Kyler Murray stepping in for Baker Mayfield, Hollywood Brown, vertical threat. But Will Greer and David Sills, make no bones about it, they belong in the conversation with some of the best in the country.
K-State got a couple of touchdowns. Minute 45 to go before half. No timeouts remaining. Thompson on the run. David Long, another tackle. Long, the junior captain, fifth leading tackler in the Big 12 last year, despite missing four games. He had a knee injury last season, but he's one of the best run stoppers.
And for Kansas State, you got to find a way to get one of your receivers, Dalton Schoen, in the conversation here in third down.
Play action. Thompson to the outside, incomplete. Well covered. Intended for Zuber, but Norwood was all over. Clock stops with a minute and 5 seconds to go before half, and it's fourth down. And now West Virginia is going to get the ball back with plenty of time and a couple of timeouts to work with.
Kansas State 0 for 6 on third down right now. West Virginia shaking off that rusty start. And this could be a huge back-breaking touchdown before half.
Just 77 yards of total offense for K-State. Fair catch called for by Sims. He juggles it, but hangs on at the 27.
So that's for carry. He'll get going. This kid's a really, really special player.
Let's see what the Heisman hopeful we have in this game could do here in a little bit of time. He's complete on his first pass to T.J. Simmons on this drive. Pickup of 12 and a first down. Simmons, the Alabama transfer.
There's something special about Will Greer in the pocket. Just be able to just bounce, stay balanced, and get some completions.
Now the shotgun throws to the outside. Find Simmons again. Boy, there's some chemistry developing between those two guys. 40 seconds to go.
If you're West Virginia, this is the benefit of having Will Greer. So composed, so mature, can run two-minute drills in his sleep.
McCoy in the backfield. Greer looks to the right, throws that way. It's Simmons again. He'll step out at the 42. Only 5 seconds went off the clock. Evan Staley, their field goal kicker. Pretty accurate guy, but they need to get him in a little closer. He missed from 51 earlier here in the half.
I promise you, Jake Spavadon and Will Greer, they're thinking touchdown.
And play action. Pocket collapsing. Got rid of it. There's a nice catch by Jennings, who dropped a touchdown pass earlier in the quarter. That's a gain of 17, and they'll hurry up to the line.
And I talked about it with Will Greer, the combination of anticipation and accuracy, cutting that ball loose so early, yet still so accurate.
Still two timeouts, going to the end zone. Sills caught at the 3, trying to wrestle his way into the end zone. Kendall Adams made the touchdown saving tackle. 15 seconds to work with. And you're right, it's 6 on their mind. McCoy lowers his head, and he is really hit hard down at the one. Sullivan made the tackle. Boy, he's slow to get up.
Charge time.
Clock stops. 5 seconds to go. Timeout, West Virginia.
6 seconds.
And now, if you're West Virginia, the question is, are you going to take a shot at the end zone with the time, or do you take the points right now? Because if you're Kansas State on defense, what you should tell your defenders secondary-wise, you hold. You take the pass interference penalty because the time's coming off the clock. And we're seeing the day that Will Grier is having so far, really building some steam with this offense and all their weapons. But if you're Kansas State on defense in this huddle, you're saying, guys, they do not score a touchdown. You hold, you grab, you tackle. The penalty doesn't matter. Then the clock, time comes off the clock. West Virginia's got to make a decision if they're going to kick the field goal or go for a touchdown again.
They put 1 second more back on the clock. So 6 seconds left. Second down, goal to go. West Virginia has one timeout left. Sills at the top of the screen. He's going to float one that way. Grier. On target, what a catch. David Sills, his second touchdown grab, and he just mossed A.J. Parker. Is that what you're saying, Dano?
Mossed. I mean, what a special talent David Sills is. I love the throw by Grier. I love the call by Jake Spavital. I mean, we're talking about a kid who was a quarterback. Was a quarterback, and now he's one of the best receivers in the country.
You nailed it. They were thinking touchdown all the way. And Staley adds the extra point. 7 plays and 73 yards in just 55 seconds. Sills with his second touchdown grab, and it's a thing of beauty.
Well, the first touchdown was a slant route. Put him by himself, slant throw. So now, in this situation, they put him out there by himself again. He takes a couple steps in, turns his head like I'm running a slant again. Goes to the back corner. It's just a different way of throwing a fade. Beautiful play design.
So a former high school quarterback, West Virginia made him a wide receiver in 2015, but he really wanted to play quarterback. So he went to JUCO in California, had some modest success there in 2016. But Dana saw something in him that was special as a wide receiver, recruited him back to Morgantown, and the rest is history.
And it's, I keep referencing how tall he is. He's not just a tall receiver. He can run routes. He understands body leverage, great hands, very smart. And Will Grier has talked about how important he is having that quarterback background, that he's impacted all the receivers on their team to get everybody to truly understand this offense, and that's how you score 21 points and a half against a good defense.
First half is over, and it didn't start well for West Virginia. They turned it over on their first two possessions, but they've got a 21-0 lead at the half. West Virginia will have the football to start the second half as well. There you see Dana Holgorsen, 43-6 when leading at the break. Coming up, Adnan, Joey, and Jim with the Lexus Halftime Report. Dan Orlovsky, Paul Carcaterra, and our crew here at Myla Pushkar Stadium. 21-0. West Virginia, the number 12 team in the country with a comfortable lead as we get ready for the second half. Will Grier, the Heisman hopeful quarterback for the Mountaineers, didn't get out to a great start here today. An interception throw on the first series. They turned it over again on the second series, but West Virginia got it together. He ends up with 3 touchdown passes in the first half.
A big part of that is that maturity that we talked about, and not only from Will Grier, but the whole football team feeling that maturity that he's bringing to this team, and they got hot near the end of the first half.
K-State, which did not get across the midfield stripe in the first half, will have the football to start the third quarter. Let's see if the offense can find some life and bring it out of the end zone. Duke Shelley trips across the 20. He's down at the 22-yard line. Will Grier, 19 of 25, 258 yards, three touchdowns, one interception. Two of those touchdown passes were to his good buddy David Sills, who was really good in that first half.
They were clicking no matter what the situation, where the ball was, down seam, finding soft zones, and obviously in the red zone. Both those guys are on a different level than so many players in college football right now.
And David Sills is another guy, Dan, that has a lot of maturity. Doesn't really care about his numbers. He's very unselfish. The numbers come. But he's also in tune to the other receivers getting their catches. He's trying to help them get plays, too. As Barnes takes a shot, gets to the 30-yard line. Paul Carcaterra.
Yards gained. That was Bill Snyder's response when I asked him what he would like to see from his offense. Down 21-0, you would think they would abandon the run game because of how far behind they are, but he wants this offense to stay balanced. He needs to see Skyler in a rhythm. Defensively, he actually thinks they played well. They're tackling well, but the offense is putting them in really tough situations.
And just 77 yards total offense. Going to get a first down here from Barnes. They were 0 for 6 on third down in the first half. And the rushing offense, which is such a staple of K-State over the years, 20 yards on the ground.
And Bill Snyder's right. This is a veteran offensive line, and they've got to start playing better, and this is an opportunity to show that here in the second half.
Skyler Thompson. 10 pass attempts. He's going to try and run here, but he's hit in the backfield and brought down. There's Javonte Stewart again.
Here's the reality. Javonte Stewart is just one of the best 11 guys on the West Virginia defense. So you find places for him, the athleticism that allows him to play in between and make a tackle on an athletic quarterback for Kansas State.
Linebacking core so thin because of injuries, and they are working around him. Deep shot, Thompson caught. Isaiah Zuber sat down to make that catch at the 20-yard line.
There's another play-action pass for Kansas State. Zuber probably supposed to be running a post, just throws his hands up. He sees the safety leave, throws his hand up, letting his quarterback know, I'm going deep, I'm changing my route. Good job by Skyler Thompson seeing him.
Gain of 40. And more of the same on the ground for K-State as Jabril Robinson, the grad transfer from Clemson, wraps up Thompson. This is the first time in West Virginia territory today for the Wildcats. Isaiah Zuber in the first half, four catches, 42 yards. It's 40 more on that reception two plays ago. K-State really needs to get points on this drive.
You can see Skyler Thompson changing the way they want to run this play.
And it's a run to Barnes, a strong one to make it third down and 4. There's Stewart again.
Skyler Thompson sensed pressure was coming off of his right side. Brought the tight end over. I want to run away from blitz. A much better and positive second down play. And now let's see if they can find Dalton Schoen, their slot receiver, on third down.
Schoen doesn't have a catch today. Third and 4. Thompson rolling Schoen's way, but he'll find Zuber again for the first down. First third down conversion today for the Cats. They were 0 for their first 6.
Just a nice job of just moving the pocket a little bit for Skyler Thompson, and then Isaiah Zuber's got such vertical speed that you're able to just get that corner to soften up. Nice cushion there. Right now, huge, huge opening drive to start this second half for Kansas State offense.
Yeah, longest drive of the day. Here's play number 8. Play fake. Thompson. Oh, that might have been tipped. Could have been picked off, too, by Derek Pitts. with three pass breakups 2 weeks ago. A penalty flag on the field.
I think they're looking at PI, but that ball was tipped, so the contact on that receiver shouldn't matter.
Yeah, Pitt's got a finger on it.
I think they're talking, was it PI, but that ball looked like it got tipped by Derek Pitts.
There's no foul on the play for defensive pass interference. The ball was tipped prior to the contact. Result of the play is an incomplete pass. It's second down.
It's really an RPO, a run-pass option. And Skylar Thompson's just reading that boundary corner, sees him blitz. That hesitation right there. He's got to pull that ball and make a decision quicker. That's what allowed that safety to get over the top by Derek Pitts, athletic, being able to blitz, stop, knock the ball away.
Second down and goal. K-State only 2 red zone touchdowns this year. Play action, incomplete. Blaze Gammon, the tight end, the intended man, can't make the catch. Third down and goal.
Really nice play design, just a little drawn out fake. Sideline to sideline, horizontal, get those linebackers to bite up, and Blaze Gammon leaks out. Got to make that catch. In this moment, down 21-0, a veteran, you got to make that catch for a young quarterback. Missed opportunity.
Zuber goes in motion. Crowd in full throat. Thompson going to call timeout. Andre Coleman, the former Wildcat, who spent the last 5 years as wide receivers coach, is now the offensive coordinator, wants to talk over the next move. Out of the K-State timeout, Andre Coleman, the new offensive coordinator, they would love to get any kind of points, but they really want a touchdown game.
This is 4 down territory right now if you get any positive play.
Third down, goal to go. Ball at the 8.
And he should see man-to-man coverage right now. West Virginia's now made a check. What does Skylar Thompson do?
Tony Gibson, does he dial up a blitz? Here comes some pressure. Picked up to the end zone. Incomplete. Zach Reuter, the senior out of Columbia, Missouri, couldn't make the catch in the back of the end zone, and it's 4th down.
West Virginia plays zone, and Kansas State not built to come back. Beautiful drive, and then 2 drop touchdowns by sure-handed veterans for this offense. Skylar Thompson knows how big those plays are to try to get back in a game against a team that can score at will.
Those are the kind of mistakes that have really been haunting the Wildcats this year, as Blake Lynch comes on for 3.
Snap, ruling on the field of an incomplete pass is under review.
We're going to look at this again. Well, they're going to take another look at Reuter's catch attempt in the back of the end zone. We'll tell you how it turns out on the other side of this break.
ESPN College Football, brought to you by eBay. If it's happening on game day, it's happening on eBay. Get all your favorite West Virginia gear for the best price with free shipping on eBay. Fill your cart with color.
20th anniversary of the 88 Mountaineers team. Here's that drop. It was confirmed that it was an incompletion. He just did not complete the catch before he was out of bounds, Dan.
Surprising. When I go back to trying to help out a young quarterback in a big moment on the road, one of those 2 passes has got to get caught.
Now 5'5" walk-on kicker Blake Lynch bangs it home from 25 yards out. He just earned a scholarship here a few weeks ago for K-State, and the Wildcats are on the board. But a disappointing ending to that drive for Bill Snyder's crew.
Absolutely, because they're not built. Kansas State is not built to come back from a big deficit. That touchdown would have been huge to cut it to 2. a two-possession game.
Number 15 for Kansas State.
Tomorrow on Sunday NFL Countdown at 10 a.m. Eastern. He has got a great sense of humor, and he is playing so well right now for Tampa.
We were drafted together.
Is that right?
He's had a remarkable career. Great guy.
You spent some time in Tampa. On the return here for West Virginia, it's Marcus Sims. He'll get to the 24.
You gotta love Fitz Magic with the swag. And Dan, before the season's over, we're gonna get Clay to have some swag. We're gonna up his gear game. We're gonna have him go to Italian restaurants with us, take chances, and actually order Italian food and not just a steak. He's a simple guy from Minnesota, but around us too, as the year progresses,
yep.
Some swag for Magic.
I'm gonna try to stay undefiled. I am the squarest guy in this booth, that's for sure.
And then Karts is swagged out for a 43-year-old as you can get.
Here's Jennings in motion as they hand off to Martel Pettaway right up the middle. And now we'll see, I would think, a lot of that running game for West Virginia guys with, you know, the lead and the guys to handle the heavy lifting back there.
I expect West Virginia to be who they are. Well, this is a team that's got big-time aspirations.
A swing pass to Pettaway, and he's undercut at the 31-yard line. It'll be third down and short. A.J. Parker has had some good moments. He's had some bad moments. That was a good one. Nice open field tackle for the Sophomore.
These are tough plays for defenders because these backs release so fast out to the flats. You've got to be able to drive and fire on a hit. A.J. Parker with a perfect form tackle.
Pettaway to the right of Greer. Greer 259 yards passing. On third down, the senior wants to throw. He's complete. There's Sills again, first down. Just short of the 40-yard line. The passing defense for K-State gave up 309 yards per game last year. They've had challenges today.
Just the route combination. Sills comes up patient. Which way am I going to go? That stacked receiver set. He comes up and nice and patient. The defender doesn't know. And again, man-to-man, it's a two-way go. David Sills too good.
Trips to the boundary. On first down, the fake to Pettaway. Greer unloading. Has a man. Devin Bush caught. Touchdown. Wow. You're right. You called it. They're going to stay true to who they are. And that's letting Greer do what he does best. 62 yards.
Just so many weapons. They put trips into the boundary. The offensive line, beautiful protection. And Tevin Bush, the sophomore from New Orleans, down the sideline.
Fourth touchdown pass for Greer. Staley with the extra point.
Kansas State missed opportunity down on their drive. West Virginia gets the ball back, capitalizes, and their Heisman Trophy candidate quarterback strikes again. As West Virginia starts to pile it on this Kansas State football team with all of their downfield weapons.
For the 12th time since coming to West Virginia, Will Greer has over 300 yards passing. He's got four touchdowns today. Tevin Bush, a good 62-yard touchdown reception moments ago. As West Virginia's piling on K-State now, Zuber is cut down at the 17-yard line.
They just put the bunch into the boundary. The outside receiver up top is going to run kind of a lazy in route. And we'll see the corner at the top of our screen for Kansas State. Drive on that in route. And it singles up Tevin Bush to run a wheel route on that nickel defender. A.J. Parker, who's in basically man-to-man coverage because of that defense. Beautiful play design by Jake Spavital of using a receiver as a decoy in a way, getting a corner to drive to vacate his area, opening up the whole sideline. Will Greer, four touchdowns already, trying to chase down Mackenzie Milton for UCF, who had six last night.
Spav has so many weapons at his disposal. And Greer finds him. Justin Silman is going to get his first carry for K-State. West Virginia says the ball came out, and it did. Turnover Wildcats, their first today.
Recovered by the defense.
Reese Donahue, the defensive end, on the recovery for the Mountaineers.
Listen, this is an absolutely explosive West Virginia offense. But this defense made it very clear to us yesterday, Clay, we matter too. We're good too. And this is going to be such a big part of this team moving forward.
Yeah, Tony Gibson, there he is, the defensive coordinator. He said, my guys have a chip on their shoulder. We knew this offseason that we were not good last year. In fact, 107th in the country in total defense. And they have been using that to galvanize the unit this year. We can be better. We've got talent to be better. And so far in 2018, they have been.
They've just been so athletic. Sideline to sideline shooting gaps that we saw right there by linebacker David Long. And they talked about Tony Gibson, their defense coordinator, how real he is, how much he cares about them, how tough he coaches them.
Dylan Tonkery, the middle linebacker who Tony Gibson called out last week for not making a tackle. He's the one who forced that fumble. Now in the red zone, Greer going back to work, intended for Sills. He stumbled. There's some contact, but no penalty flag. A.J. Parker was covering Sills.
Reggie Walker lays a pretty good hit on Will Greer in the pocket. A beautiful move. Greer hung in there. That's a well-thrown football. It just looks like David Sills' feet just get tangled up just as the last second. But I promise you, West Virginia is going to keep going for the jugular here on offense.
They're going to run it. Letty Brown, the freshman, gets it to the 10-yard line. Third down and short. Walker and Adams on the stop.
One of the things that you can see is West Virginia has all these weapons that can spread you out, and as a defense, you have to marry that. And that's the second or third nicely run draw we've seen from West Virginia because the numbers in the box favor them so much.
Greer. Sills. Dives. Did he get there? Now they're going to mark him up, but they are talking about it.
Out of bounds at the 1 yard line. First down.
It's that same stacked set. Sills comes up super patient, can break either way. Looks like his right foot stepped out of bounds just before he stretches out. But don't worry, we're coming back to you.
3 quick strike scoring drives already today, under a minute 45. This could be another one. Greer. Sills. His third touchdown catch of the day.
I cannot say enough about the route running from David Sills. The patience at the line of scrimmage. Step on a bunch of ants, and just the suddenness to stick a foot outside and get back inside on the slant.
Fifth touchdown catch of the year for Sills. He had 18 of them last year. Staley bangs it home. West Virginia heavy favorites here today, and it's bearing out. the fourth touchdown drive for West Virginia this afternoon. Under 2 minutes. That one took 1:08. Back here in Morgantown, alongside Dan Orlovsky. Played 13 years in the NFL after a college career at UConn. I'm Clay Matvick. Paul Carcaterra roaming the sidelines here at Milan Pushkar Stadium. They were fired up for this game here today, the Big 12 opener. After that long layoff, the NC State game last weekend, wiped out because of Hurricane Florence. And West Virginia has come to play after a bit of a slow start. Will Greer to David Sills. It was awesome last year, and it's going to be a great 2018, it appears.
No doubt. And the thing when you get into the red zone is, what do you do with him? I mean, he's that much of a mismatch, and you can see the trust that he has in Will Greer and then Will Greer has in him. They're not unstoppable. They are today, but they're going to make so many defensive coordinators in the Big 12 stay up late trying to figure out, how do we defend these two incredible players?
And then if you start to concentrate too much on Sills, you do it at your own peril. This could be a delay of game in K-State.
5-yard penalty. It's first down.
Listen, I played with a guy in the NFL by the name of Calvin Johnson, and I'm not saying David Sills is Calvin Johnson, but the impact Calvin had down in the red zone was, he freed up so much other stuff for everybody else on our team because he was such a mismatch problem. David Sills presents that kind of issue for defenses.
Not just Sills, it's Jennings, it's Marcus Sims, it's TJ Simmons, who's had a great day here today. 3 catches, 31 yards. Good run for Skylar Thompson as he gets across the 20-yard line to the 23.
And Clay, when we're looking at college football, and the best quarterback receiver doers are the ones doing it at the highest level right now, certainly Tua, who's probably doing something really awesome right now in their game. Kyler Murray, Hollywood Brown, CeeDee Lamb, Will Greer, and David Sills having a huge afternoon. And the Big 12 as a whole, as a conference, TCU's got some incredible weapons with Jalen Reagor and Kevontae Turpin. Texas has got some big-time guys, but David Sills and Will Greer are going to make a lot of noise this year.
Alex Barnes with a carry of 9 yards. You know, some think West Virginia's a college playoff dark horse. I know you're in that camp. They did lose the NC State game, so that means they're going to have 11 regular season games, 12 if they make the Big 12 title game. And if they do, and they win that, and it would presumably be against Oklahoma or a TCU, perhaps, maybe Oklahoma State, then you got to think that they're in the college football playoff.
Oh, absolutely. I mean, there's, if that's the track that they go on and they fight and beat in Oklahoma or Oklahoma State, absolutely.
Now, the Big 12, once considered an outlier for the college football playoff, but you look at it right now and the league is in pretty good shape.
That November is going to be, that's when you're really going to figure out what kind of team you have. At Texas, at OK State with TCU and Oklahoma. Texas, TCU, Oklahoma State, Oklahoma in a 4-week stretch.
Third down. This has been an Achilles heel for K-State. Thompson will get the first down out to the 40.
See Skylar Thompson get knocked out of the field of play. But Dana Holgorsen said, from a depth, a skill, a leadership standpoint, this is as good of a bunch as he's had since he's been at West Virginia. The big challenge now, though, is the Big 12. Because of the offenses, because of those prolific quarterbacks, Dan, that you mentioned, the real test is yet to come.
Well, there'll be a Texas Tech next week. West Virginia has won 5 in a row in that series. And he said it's really heavy as far as degree of difficulty on the back end. That's a wide open man at the 33. Caught by Dalton Schoen, his first reception, but then he lost the football. Are they going to mark him down, though? They're going to rule Shone down after the catch at the 26. It's a gain of 35 for Dalton Shone, who has been eerily quiet today for the K-State offense.
Ruling on the field is a catch. The runner was down, and then the defender ripped the ball out of his arms. It's first down.
I will say this, Clay. This defense, for as good as they have been vulnerable to play action passes. We see Dalton Shone downfield again. Looks like he's down before that ball completely gets ripped out.
They're going to take another look. West Virginia calling a timeout to give the officials chance to look at it again.
Wondering if his hip is down before that ball starts to get jarred out. But there you see Javonte Stewart, who's kind of been the talk of the night for this West Virginia defense, and how fast he's been able to play downfield. Getting beat in play action, no doubt, but not quitting. And does that ball start to get out?
West Virginia is challenging the ruling on the field that the runner was down prior to losing the football.
So Dana Holgorsen is going to use a challenge here. You're right, that linebacking core, you know, fraught with injuries for West Virginia. Javonte Stewart has moved into take a linebacking spot. But they are so versatile, so athletic on the back end and at the linebacking spot here at West Virginia. Everybody's an athlete. You see Stewart there making another nice play. Now, whether it'll be a turnover or not, we'll have to wait and see.
The versatility is a huge deal for this defense, and being able to mix and match where guys play, no matter if it's safety, if it's linebacker, the speed that they have to be able to play with sideline to sideline. That's one of the interesting things about this defense, is because they do such a nice job up front of getting penetration that really allows all those athletes on that second level, their linebackers, to play with speed. And we asked David Long, what's it like to be able to do that as an athletic linebacker? And he said, it's such a freeing thing to know that there's no hesitation with them, that they can go play fast, and it's going to pay dividends in a Big 12 conference.
I think Shone is down. Looks like he's got control, and that right knee is down. It's got to be indisputable video evidence to overturn the call on the field. The call on the field was a completion and runner down at the 26.
After reviewing the play, the ruling that the runner was down prior to losing the football is confirmed. West Virginia will be charged a timeout.
And Dana Holgorsen is out of challenges now for the rest of the football game.
It's the right call. It looked like Dalton Shone's hip had gotten down before that ball got ripped out. And I'll go back to this. West Virginia's been hit with some play-action passes on defense. If I'm Kansas State and Andre Coleman, I can't call enough of those right now.
So that's officially the second longest play of the day offensively for K-State, a gain of 35. K-State now 213 yards of total offense, finally starting to pick it up a bit. Thompson sits clean in the pocket, throws to the outside, and there is Shone again, caught at the 20. Dalton Shone, a former walk-on. We have seen him develop some pretty good chemistry with that guy, Skylar Thompson. Last week, a 42-yard touchdown catch between those two. Shone had a breakout season last year. And if K-State's going to, you know, compete to be bowl eligible this year, those two guys are going to have to make plays.
Top five pass catcher in the history of this program, who's produced some good receivers. Played scout team together a bunch. And Skylar Thompson, when he throws in rhythm, when he plays in rhythm in the pocket, is very effective throwing the ball.
Thompson feeling the heat. He's going to be sacked. David Long. First sack of the day for the West Virginia defense. But they've been giving Thompson fits really all day.
Well, it's by design. they bring seven guys up to the line of scrimmage. Who's coming as an offensive line? You don't know. And it just takes one offensive lineman to not understand exactly everybody's responsibilities, and you get a free rusher for David Long's and the West Virginia defense.
Now there might have been motion for K-State. Yep.
Ball start. Offense.
Scott France, who has started every game of his career at right tackle. Tonight, number 30.
And that's unlike him. Scott France, such a good player. The whole offensive line, so experienced.
Said right tackle, should have said left tackle. That backs him up. So now third and 17. Need the 16-yard line. Thompson's going to be tracked down from behind by Keith Washington, the former Michigan Wolverine. And it's fourth down.
And another cornerback blitz dialed up by Tony Gibson, who's got his fingerprints all over today's game defensively. Really one step ahead of Andre Coleman in the Kansas State offense, especially with their blitz packages.
Tony Gibson's having a lot of fun coaching this group. That is the sixth tackle for loss today for the West Virginia D, as Blake Lynch is not going to come out to attempt a long field goal. They're going to bring the punter, Bernardo Rodriguez. Andrew Hicks has also punted for K-State. And that's going to be a delay of game, so they're going to back K-State up even more here.
We mentioned Tony Gibson a ton today, West Virginia's defensive coordinator. How much fun was it to sit and talk with him yesterday? And just, it seemed like a dude. You know, we just, the conversation, talking sports, talking life, talking football, West Virginia, how much this place means to him. It was really, really awesome, 30 minutes spent with him.
He's going to sail into the end zone and be a touchback. Will Greer will come back out on
this. Some nastiness to Oregon. How about Stanford and Oregon? Six out of the last 7 years, the winner of that game has gone on to win the Pac-12 North, so that's got long-term ramifications.
No doubt about it. With that lead, maybe for the college football playoff, it's Kennedy McCoy carries on that play. Pickup of 8 for the junior running back.
You know, Mario Cristobal was on College Game Day this morning. Live interview, he said, this is 6 in the morning out there, said he wants Boston Stadium to break the decibel record tonight.
And they might. University of Oregon, that's where they shot Animal House 40 years ago. A nice feature on that on Game Day. McCoy cuts it up, but he's got the first down. About a minute and a half to go here in the third quarter.
West Virginia going to take some time here now. Very comfortable within this game. We're getting close to the end of the third quarter. Still run your offense, but you're not at some crazy tempo right now.
338 yards passing for Greer. And he throws a second interception. That was picked off by Jonathan Durham, the Kansas State nickelback. Second interception of the day, third of the year for Will Greer.
Durham doing a really nice job of just running out underneath this route. It's almost like Will Greer didn't even see him. He cuts this ball loose with such confidence to David Sills, and Durham just playing a buzz coverage, running underneath the out route. Ball's thrown right to him. Uncharacteristic and somewhat of a lazy throw by Will Greer, who's had such a remarkable afternoon.
Almost a 77% completion rate coming into the day today. Threw 12 interceptions last year. That was an area he really wanted to clean up. And that's his third pick now on the season as Alex Delton comes in to run the offense for the first time for K-State. And he's a quick runner, and he gets into the secondary and inside the 20-yard line down to the 19. He's the quicker of the two quarterbacks, Thompson and Delton. They had a pretty good battle in camp. They've kind of settled on Thompson here, but now maybe the competition's open again. We'll have to see.
Yeah, these are always tough situations for a backup to come into. You're getting beat pretty handily, and you're expected, hey, go play after sitting for a couple quarters. But here's an opportunity for Delton.
Delton pumps, throws to the end zone, has a receiver, and it's incomplete. Intended for Zuber, and it's out of bounds. Let's go to Adnan Burke. But Foster's defense having trouble with Old Dominion today as Delton goes to the 15-yard line and then takes a bump. Third turnover forced by K-State, Dan, but they have not scored any points off the turnovers so far today.
It's remarkable. They're plus two right now in the turnover differential. They've gotten three. Kansas State has turned it over once themselves. But losing 35-3, you're not going to see that a lot, no matter what level of football you're at.
Delton. The Zuber. And he's going to get the first down inside the 10, and that's going to be the last play of the third quarter. A couple of touchdowns here in the quarter for West Virginia. Greer now has five touchdown passes on the day. All Mountaineers here in Morgantown, 35-3, heading to the fourth. Here's Andre Coleman. His offense has struggled to score points today. West Virginia turned it over on its first two possessions of the afternoon, but you can see that they collected themselves behind their Heisman candidate, Will Greer, quarterback. He has thrown five touchdown passes today. Skylar Thompson, the starter for K-State quarterback, is out right now. Alex Delton, the junior from Hayes, Kansas, is in. And he'll give it to Alex Barnes. Flag in.
Holding offense number 79. 10-yard penalty. It's first down.
And that's going to be the fifth penalty against K-State. There's nothing that makes Bill Snyder more unhappy than penalties and turnovers, and we're starting to see those collect now for the Wildcats.
Absolutely. I mean, this is a program that prides itself on doing the little things and playing consistent football and allowing other teams to beat themselves. And for what we've seen in an experienced offensive line, have some foolish penalties and now miscues with drops, this is very uncharacteristic of this team, and Bill Snyder will let them know.
They had 13 penalties in the season opener against South Dakota. And they had to claw back, come from behind to beat an FCS program because of those penalties. To the end zone, incomplete, intended for Zuber. Derek Pitts has been busy. It'll be second down and goal from the 20.
Zuber, the sudden receiver, runs a double move. Kind of like a post or a deep sluggo and go. He's got the receiver beat. You just love to see Delton drive that ball to the back pylon or throw it up high to the front pylon. Either one, Zuber's gonna be able to go and make that catch.
Incomplete. Barnes left on the turf. And so now third down and goal. Alex Delton, the quarterback, started four games last year after Jesse Ertz was lost for the year. Then he suffered a concussion and missed the rest of the regular season before coming back to have a really big game in the Cactus Bowl in that win over UCLA. Trying to lead K-State into the end zone for the first time here in Morgantown today. Seventh play of the drive, and you can see third down has been abysmal for the Wildcats. Play action. Delton, good speed. Gets around the corner, but now he's cut off. Out of bounds. Fourth down. There's David Long. Darius Stills in pursuit. And they're going to run the field goal kicker, Blake Lynch, out there.
It's kind of the story of the game. Not being truly able to capitalize off a turnover. Now we have a field goal attempt, but this is the third turnover from West Virginia that you haven't turned into a touchdown if you're the Kansas State offense.
This will be a 38-yard attempt for Lynch. She's also kicked from 25 and made it. He's having a good year. Athletic department janitor to help pay for school, recently put on scholarship. And it's now 35-6. School's general scholarship fund. We say thank you to Allstate. Alongside Dan Orlovsky, I'm Clay Matvick, Paul Carcaterra down on the field. It's all West Virginia. And it really has been since the early moments of the second quarter. 35-6 after the second field goal of the day for Blake Lynch. K-State kicks off, and it's a fair catch. It'll be brought out to the 25. Let's go to Adnan Virk. Yeah. All right, so Alabama taking control as we assumed they would. There's a hit in the backfield. As West Virginia has the football. As Martell Petaway on the run. They're starting to do the wave here, Dano. They are enjoying themselves as Will Greer and the West Virginia offense has really put on a show. The defense has played well. The season looks bright here in 2018 for the Mountaineers.
Well, when I got into town Thursday night, Friday morning I went down in our hotel to go get a coffee and get my coffee and then go to pay for it. And the guy's like, no, it's on me. And I said, no. And he's like, no, ESPN, you're doing the game tomorrow, right? And I said, yeah. And he goes, man, we haven't had a game in 2 weeks. And I was like, huh? And he's like, what do you think of the game tomorrow? We haven't had football in 2 weeks. So this wave is a crowd that has been starved of football for 2 weeks, but also knows that they have got a football team that is going to be in the national conversation for many weeks moving forward.
Trying to pick up a third down here. Look at that ability to slide up. Got a receiver. Penalty flags down. And there's another penalty flag. A flag in the backfield, a flag in the secondary. They're both going to be against K-State, we think. Gary Jennings, the intended receiver.
Now, Will Greer is a kid who has been around football a long time. His dad is a well-accomplished high school football coach. And just those sudden movements in the pocket don't happen overnight. You can see that.
There are two fouls on the play by the defense. Personal foul. Illegal hands to the face. Number 51. His penalty is declined. Pass interference. Number 7. 15-yard penalty from the previous spot. Automatic first down.
Those little movements in the pocket that he has is something that has been a part of his football game a long time. Beautiful job of climbing in the pocket and driving the ball downfield with some air to Jennings. Just the subtle movement. Make a defender miss, keep my eyes downfield, protect the football. Enough air downfield with the pass to Jennings. Gets the PI. That's how you go 24 or 33 for almost 340 yards and 5 touchdowns. Playing quarterback, not just throwing.
No handoff to Petaway. Petaway cuts it up. There's another flag down as Petaway gets to the 49-yard line. Greer put up huge numbers last year.
Offense, number 78. 10-yard penalty. It's first down.
This is going to come back. Greer put up 372 and 4 touchdowns in the win over K-State in Manhattan. He's had 338 yards passing, 5 touchdowns today. No one will sneeze at those 2 picks.
That first interception is a miscommunication thing. They're going to happen throughout the season. The second one, uncharacteristic of him, but the level that he's playing at, the consistent level that he's operating at the line of scrimmage, seeing if the box count is good for their run game, finding matchups in their pass game, high completions.
Well, he almost threw another interception. Nearly picked off by A.J. Parker. Dominique Maiden, the intended receiver. So he's second down and long. You see the numbers of 2017 compared to what he's done so far this year. Talked about the completion percentage, an area he really wants to bring up, and so far he has.
And those are Heisman type of numbers. And if they continue to play at this level and continue to win, they'll be in the conversation.
A key man in that K-State secondary, Kendall Adams, being helped to his feet. We'll step aside.
Extra yard for Teachers Week is a celebration of teachers led by the College Football Playoff Foundation through its Extra Yard for Teachers platform. Visit the College Football Playoff Foundation website, www.collegefootball-foundation.org, to learn more about Extra Yard for Teachers Week.
And we got a penalty flag down, and Paul, Bill Snyder was a high school teacher back in the day.
Bill Snyder, gentlemen, was actually an English and Spanish teacher for 9 years prior to becoming a college football coach. Growing up in St. Joseph, Missouri, he was raised by his mother, and many teachers had a profound impact on his life. One who inspired him, he told me, was Helen Conkright, who happened to be the legendary broadcaster Walter Conkright's sister.
It's pretty remarkable when you do some conversations with him, the accountability that that teacher of his past has brought onto this Kansas State football team. You know, we talked about recruiting. They don't talk football when he goes to a recruit. It's all about, how am I going to develop you as a man, as a father? They've got some rules. You've got to get to class. If you don't, you call your parents. If you cuss in front of a coach, you call your mother and let her know. Just that program standard that he's learned from being a teacher for so many years is really been a big part of this Kansas State turnaround over the past, what, two decades?
Yeah, he says he really misses teaching, too. Consider going back to doing it there after he left Kansas State for the first time. Of course, he was forced back as Letty Brown makes the carry there. It's going to be fourth down here for West Virginia.
He's not going anywhere either.
No. He just signed another deal. He's going to turn 79 here in a few weeks. Got a 5-year extension last month. And yeah, he's still strong and looks good. He did have a battle with throat cancer last year that caused him to lose some weight. But he's really in great health and very sharp.
And one of their leaders, Duke Shelley, a lockdown corner for them, has said they've learned so much from Coach Snyder and how he's fought that disease. It's taught them, we're not going to complain about anything. If Coach can do it, we can do it.
10:42, the game is in hand for West Virginia.
And this is just a little thing for Will Greer, but on the left, he squared stance. That's how he used to play at Florida, and he wanted to know, how can I go to the next level? So he's dropped his right foot back, brought his left foot a little bit forward. His big thing is, I always want to be in position to throw the football. And that's just this little thing that he's made into his game that's really had profound impact and results for him playing the quarterback spot.
Ball start. Offense number seven. 5-yard penalty. It's first down.
You know, and you were talking about that stance in the shotgun, and some of the great NFL quarterbacks do it.
Brady, Matt Ryan, Rodgers, guys who are known for always being ready to throw the ball. Nothing affects them around them, and they're able to deliver the ball in tight spaces. And that's what we're seeing out of Will Greer, that ability to make those throws, moving in the pocket, quickly out of his hands. That's a big deal. For me, when I played, I was a right foot forward guy. I was never at the level of those guys in the NFL or even a Will Greer. But I kept my right foot forward because I was a longer dropped guy. It wasn't that much on my mind getting the ball out so quickly. But you're talking about a guy that had incredible success at Florida and decided, how can I get better? And just that little change, that 6-inch change in his step, has allowed him to play at such an efficient level. And he's got so many weapons on the outside. It's catch the snap, how can I get it out? Catch the snap, who's an open option? It's really impressive that a young kid was that mature to make that choice.
Back-to-back big plays by Zuber and Shun. K-State's got it at the 25, as you Look at Will Greer. 338 yards passing, 5 touchdowns today. Delton is going to take off. Not a lot of operating room. He's going to pick up maybe a yard. As we go to Adnan Virk in the... All right, Adnan, thanks. That's not exactly what you and I and Paul wanted to hear. We're going to see West Virginia Tech next week. There's another run for K-State. Offense so hard to come by today. They're well under 300 yards total offense. It's going to be a loss of one. Will Greer and that footwork, especially the stance, that's something he and Spav talked a long time about.
It's all about how can you go to the next level? How can you become go from good to becoming a great quarterback? And what we've seen here today is great quarterback play, is Heisman Trophy conversation quarterback play. Because last night, I mentioned it before, Mackenzie Milton for UCF, who's going to be in that conversation, had a big night, 6 touchdowns. We saw Will Greer today kind of answer that call.
Another tackle for loss for the West Virginia Mountaineers defense. This time, Jeffrey Pooler getting in the act, and that's sack number 3 for West Virginia.
And I don't think we can emphasize enough the impact of his dad and his relationship, that it's centered around football. It truly is centered around football. And that's why we're seeing Will Greer be this kind of refined, high-level product playing quarterback, and it started at such a young age with his dad.
His dad, Chad. In fact, I think Chad's here today. 50-yard attempt for Lynch. No. Didn't get it. He's hit a couple of field goals today, but not able to bang that one in from long range. 35-6. We're going to talk more about Will Greer's family when we come back to Morgantown.
The Greer family in attendance. Will's brother, Nash, who's on the left in the yellow shirt, and Hayes are famous through YouTube and Instagram. Both are influencers who connect directly with their audience through the phone, holding a camera in the hand, and looking at the audience in the eyes. These guys are incredible in terms of their original content and the way that they're able to touch people through social media. Look at these followers.
Man. 9.9 million for Nash Greer. Look at Will. Yeah, he's 604,000 followers, and that's not a bad number, but he's not the most famous person in his family, and he could win the Heisman Trophy this year.
Well, Clay, just take heart to the fact that you're only 9,800,999 followers short of Nash, but
might be more than that, actually. Look at some of the stars from professional sports that we found their numbers. Kobe Bryant, Tom Brady, Mike Trout. They all fall short of Nash Greer. Tom Brady doesn't have as many as Hayes Greer. Mike Trout barely has more than Skylin Greer.
You know, someone like you, Clay, will ask, why? Well, they exactly. Let people into their lives. It's the new reality TV. Every kid has a phone. Every kid can be spoken to, and these guys have mastered that.
Will's still in there. He's thrown 5 touchdowns today. He's got another long completion here to Marcus Sims, who does a nice dance to avoid some tacklers. Then he gets clotheslined at the 41-yard line. So, Kark, give me an example of something that is on Hayes Greer's Instagram, Twitter, whatever.
It could be anything. It could be him plucking a cucumber.
Plucking
out of the ground.
A cucumber.
It could be him jumping off a small cliff into water. But the way that they're able to connect with the younger generation, like I said before, they're speaking to these young people who consume media way different than you, way different than Dan, way different than me.
So you're saying I have no shot to get up to his level. It's a carry from McCoy. All right, big family man. We've established that. His wife is Jeannie. He's got an almost 2-year-old daughter, Eloise. Just a beautiful young family. See some pictures of Ellie. And Will has a mom, Elizabeth. She lives in Charlotte, North Carolina. We talked about dad, Chad. He's in Charleston, South Carolina, high school football coach. So obviously he was very concerned about the path of Hurricane Florence last week. Fortunately, none of the family hurt. No big problems there. But he really is a well-grounded young man.
And he grew up around football, in football offices with his dad. We've talked about his family. I'll tell you what, though, when we had the chance to talk to him yesterday, football, 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 I don't know if it was you, Clay, or Kark mentioned his daughter, and his demeanor changed, his speaking changed, and you can tell how important family is to him. You can tell how important his own father is to him.
His dad coached him at Davidson Day School in North Carolina. He won a couple of championships. And now he's a head coach at Oceanside Collegiate Academy in South Carolina. And he was down on the sideline earlier today, talking football with his boy. That's intercepted. Jack Allison, the backup to Will Greer, had it deflected and picked up by Jerron McPherson for K-State. Intercepted. And that is the third interception thrown today by the West Virginia quarterbacks. Win over Missouri. You see Clemson leading Georgia Tech. Penalty flags down on this play. Let's talk about your top five, Dan, you know, as it stands right
offense
now.
Offense number 89, 10-yard penalty. It's first down.
I mean, Alabama is no doubt a juggernaut right now, playing at, I mean, all cylinders. Their offense and defense could be the best two groups in all of college football. Georgia playing very well. So many weapons for Jake Fromm. Clemson, until someone comes and beats Clemson, they're in the conversation. Ohio State with Dwayne Haskins and all the weapons they have, and now no longer being two-dimensional. And then Oklahoma, I've mentioned Kyler Murray and their weapons. The question for Oklahoma is, can you play a little bit better on defense? Can you tackle a little bit better on defense? But a lot of really good football teams right now, 1 through 7, 8, 9 across the country, Alabama leading that charge.
Greer with the baseball cap on. It appears his day is over. 3.5 to go. 35-6, West Virginia is going to go to 3-0. As Zuber steps out at the 31. That'll be a plays under the big lights, the Oregon QB. And Bryce Love should be back to full speed tonight for Stanford. Zuber again over the middle. And he's down at the 46-yard line. Justin Herbert. He is a tall quarterback, kind of like you. You're, what, 6'5", 6'6"?
Yeah, he's a lot better thrower and more athletic than I ever was. But Herbert playing at such a phenomenal level for Oregon. Drew Locke actually had a really good day today, throwing the football against a good Georgia defense. Jared Stidham, I'm not on the Jared Stidham train like some people are. I don't believe he's played up to the standard, the expectation level. I really look forward to watching Ryan Finley play. And we got to see Will Greer today, right? I mean, we got to see Will Greer bring Thanksgiving a little bit early to Morgantown with a full carb session against Kansas State's defense.
His second 5-touchdown pass game of the season, and we're only 3 games in for West Virginia. He threw 5 against Tennessee in his hometown of Charlotte.
And we're looking at him right now on television, a bunch of people around him smiling. And I promise you, those two picks that he threw today, one, not a bad decision, but those two picks will bother him.
Gnaw at him a little bit?
Yeah, I mean, I was just very impressed with, in talking with him, his expectation level for himself. Those will bother him. He knows as good as he played, he can play better. You know, speaking of Stanford tonight with Oregon.
West Virginia, 30 seconds.
Now, West Virginia's called a timeout. I'm going to step aside here and get an update in the studio with Adman. All right. Yeah, still a lot of time there for the Hokies, but they're running out of it.
Come on. Come on, Tech. But I was going to mention the Stanford and Oregon game tonight. Justin Herbert, Oregon's quarterback, playing so well. Stanford quarterback K.J. Costello having a great year, being able to throw the ball to J.J. Arcega-Whiteside downfield. So two really good quarterbacks in that game tonight.
Alex Delton is complete to Reuter, who dropped a touchdown pass earlier in this game, and he gets inside the 35. Football Today, SportsCenter after the game on ESPN and the ESPN app. It's incomplete. Minute 15 to go here in Morgantown. This has been a fun week getting ready for this game. The fans were excited for it after a no game last weekend. The Florence situation wiped out that game at NC State. So Will Grier and the West Virginia Mountaineers had a long time to think about this first conference game against K-State. Again, the first two series didn't look so hot, but boy, Will Grier and this offense impressive today. And there's another sack. The defense for West Virginia hasn't been too shabby either. And West Virginia will take on Texas Tech in Lubbock next week.
That's going to be a thrown around the grass game. Texas Tech's quarterback Bowman throwing for like 600 yards last week, breaking Patrick Mahomes' Big 12 freshman record. Kansas playing better, too.
Oh, they're playing a lot better.
Iowa State, good defense, so they'll be tested a little bit over the next couple weeks, but, man, that month of November.
It's a meat grinder. Delton over the middle, and that's going to be thrown incomplete.
But the conference is anybody's right now. It's anybody's right now. There's no team in the Big 12 that you're going to point to and go, wow, they're so much better than everybody else.
I might bring Will Grier out for a curtain call. Yep. Here he comes. What a day for him. Will Grier, 5 touchdown passes today, 356 yards through the air. Now has 14 touchdown strikes in 3 games. West Virginia, 3-0. And a college football playoff dark horse.
What a treat to come to Morgantown today. Watch not only the West Virginia defense play at a high level, but get to see one of America's best quarterbacks and receiving groups play, highlighted by Will Grier and David Sills.
Let's go down to Paul, who's with Will Grier.
5 touchdowns. What allowed you to be so successful through the air tonight?
Got a lot of things to clean up. You know, the O-line did a really good job today. I'm really proud of that group and what they were able to do today. They've come a long way and continue to work hard and prove that they're a really strong group. A lot of things still to work on in the passing game. I thought we got lazy with some stuff. We need to execute better. We did some things well, obviously, but that wasn't a clean game. So we expect to play a better game next week.
Always looking for perfection, but you're ability to connect with David Sills, 3 touchdowns for him tonight. Why is that combination so successful?
He's lethal in the red zone, man. He knows how to position himself to get open, and he makes tough catches in the red zone. And, I trust him to come down with it. I just put it near him down there, and he makes big-time plays.
For you, you're a quarterback, but you're a dad as well. During home games in Morgantown, what's the first thing you do with your daughter, Ellie, when you see her?
She doesn't come to the game, so when I get home, she runs to me. And now when she hugs me, she pats me. That's her thing now, so I'm looking forward to that. I love doing that every week.
Embrace those pats. Congratulations.
Thank you, guys.
Country Roads plays in the background. It's another win for West Virginia. They're 3-0. They've got a Heisman contender in Will Grier. Coming up next on ESPN, College Football Scoreboard with Adnan, Joey, and Jim. For Paul Carcaterra, Dan Orlovsky, I'm Clay Matvick. We say so long from Morgantown.